Hi guys, in this video, you'll learn about what you can do if you do not have relatives in the US when you're applying to DDS. Now, one very important thing to think about is how can I reduce my costs when I come to the US? And second is, what are the different visas under which I can visit the US? Let's first go through the different visas that you can apply to the US with. We have a couple of them. One which is not so popular, but is a good option in countries like Iran, Iraq, and a few other countries that have maybe ravaged by war is called the asylum visa. You can also apply for an asylum visa in a country that's not under a crisis or war, like India, if you were to be a transgender, or if you were lesbian or gay, and there was an attack on your personal life. By declaring what threat exists, you can apply to an asylum visa in the US. On a lottery basis, you might actually get it. The next one is the most popular, a tourist visa. For a tourist visa, you'll need to have at least a visiting address in the US. So you may require a relative, a friend, or somebody else, even an institution that's willing to invite you for a particular reason. Many people we know come on the tourist visa to the US to take their board exams. The next one is what we call a business visa, B2. Now, you might see that the tourist visa and the business visa is technically the same, but they're given for different purposes. If you were to apply for the B2 visa, you can talk about the different conferences that you have been invited to. And as you have known, since the number of conferences for dentistry is umpteen, you don't necessarily have to be invited to a top-notch, prestigious conference. You can be invited to a very small conference that you almost self-invited yourself to by paying $500 or lesser. By having multiple conference invites, you can make a very compelling case at the visa office saying that you are wanted by this country and you need to come soon. It's good to additionally book a few venues like hotels that you might be staying at and take the proof of these booking information along with your conference invitations to the visa office to make sure you get the visa without hassle. The next one is going to be PR or citizenship. Probably the most difficult to acquire unless you have somebody who's already in the US who can apply on your behalf. The permanent residency would come to you based on your country of birth. So if you're born in a country which has a lot of immigrants that come to the US, like India, it might take anywhere between 6 and 14 years. Whereas if you come from a country like Czechoslovakia, for example, which sends very few immigrants to the US, you might get your PR even within a year. So it's a good option to consider, especially if you have somebody who can sponsor you from US already. The next one is an F1 or an L1 visa. F1 visa is for students, and L1 visa is a work permit visa. So if you are able to apply to a job from a different country into the US, you can come through an L1 visa. An alternative option is to ask your employer to sponsor you to come and work in the US. Now, because healthcare is a very nuanced subject, people who come through the L1 visa to the US are not put through the same rigorous trauma that an engineer or some other professional is put through. The L1 visa justification must be this. If the company that's sponsoring you is able to prove that that particular resource or that particular talent is in a lot of demand in the US and can only be done by somebody who travels from the outside, then you get an L1 visa. Because the number of dentists are always in high demand in the US, getting an L1 visa as a dentist is very easy. So if you are working at a private practice, or if you own a private practice, as the owner of the private practice, you can sponsor an L1 visa for yourself and visit the US. F1 visas are pretty straightforward. Like I said, it's a student visa. All you need is a valid admit from a school or a program that you'll of your preference, and you can come to the US. Many people take bridge programs like MPH or MHA to come to the US and then use that time period to get experience and eventually crack the DDS process. A couple of others might do other science programs, either related or not so related to dentistry. The next one is what we call a dependent visa. There are a plethora of dependent visas. The most popular amongst them are H-B-4, EB2 and L2 visa. Now basically a dependent visa is pretty straightforward. If somebody on whom you are dependent, either your parents or your spouse, is already in the US and has a legal work permit, then they can sponsor you to come as their dependent to the US. This is probably the most used visa that we have seen among applicants, either husbands of existing spouses in the US or wives of existing people in the US. They come down to the US as a dependent, spend a few years, use that to collect, gather experience, maybe have a few children in the process, and eventually apply to a DDS program. Now that we've seen the exhaustive list of visas with which you can come to the US, please do not think it's difficult and you are only restrained to come through the tourist visa, which is what is widely published out there. Let's move on to the next topic. The next topic is, what if I do not have a relative or a friend who will sponsor me in the US when I visit them? What are the alternative options I can explore to reduce my overall costs of staying in the US? Now, we have kind of put together a small list based on Noura and my experience of traveling across the US and spending as little as possible to minimize costs. The first one is what all of us know and probably the most expensive option, an Airbnb or a hotel like Extended Stay America. The biggest cost of staying in America is not actually the living cost, it's the cost of food and grocery. So if you are able to get an Airbnb in a remote place, you would not be spending more than $40 odd per day. And you can cook by yourself, which will bring down the biggest expense that you might have to do if you are staying outside. The next one is to look at student exchange programs. Manipal University has a student exchange program with University of Iowa, and every year they send one student to the US. There may be other student exchange programs that are not affiliated with your university per se, but still send students over. There are specific exchange programs exclusively for women leaders. So if you are a woman in a foreign country and you're able to prove yourself as an entrepreneurially minded person or a young leader out there, either due to community service or due to the fact that you own a private practice, you can apply to one of these exchange programs and come to the US for absolutely free. The next one is what we call school dormitories. Multiple schools in the US, especially during their off season, which is your winter break and summer break, have dormitories that you can rent out and use. I myself have applied to a school dormitory at the school of BU, and while I did not stay there, I was able to apply. You do not have to be a student of the US to apply to these school dormitories. This is just additional income for the schools in off season, and you can exploit that. It's pretty cheap. The next one is what we call youth hostels. Again, youth hostels are of two types. One is religiously affiliated and individual ones. Youth hostels like those by YMCA or YWCA are pretty popular. There are also more religiously affiliated hostels. If you are a Christian, then through your Christian community organizations, you will be able to access cheap hostel options in the US, which would be as low as $15 a day and can get you all the facilities you need. The good part is you might also see a like-minded group like you, which is traveling and in the student community, that can get you access to frugal resources. Make sure to ask your local church or your local religious institutions for any affiliation that they might have. One other famous institution I personally know of is Isha Yoga, which has youth hostels based in the US and can sponsor your travel back and forth. The next one is what we call couchsurfing. Couchsurfing.com is a website which allows global travelers to host one another for absolutely free. You just need to pay a $75 one-time deposit to the website, which to do a security check or background check on who you are. After that, you can apply to as many houses or as many locations across the US and stay on literally on their couch for absolutely free. This is a safe and verified option, which few of our dentists have explored in the past. The only thing that you might have to do is accommodate the interests of the host, because you exactly may not be a house guest. The last one is looking at rental cars instead of just having to purchase a car, and looking at these through Facebook Marketplace. Facebook Marketplace is only available in a few countries outside the US, so it might be likely that you're unaware of this option, but it's just a simple online store which is hosted on Facebook, and the prices are pretty cheap because Facebook does not take a commission of every sale, unlike on other platforms. Another platform that you can probably explore is called Letgo, and specifically for people from the Asian subcontinent, South Asian subcontinent, there is a website called Suleika.com, which you can explore and has a lot of options with like-minded people from similar races. The last one is what we call college towns. A college town in the US is a town which has a very, very popular university. Now, big towns in the US which host a famous college like UPenn might actually be earning 30% or more of their revenue only because of the presence of that college. College towns are typically cheap because they have good public transport facility, they have college-assisted initiatives, and they have cheap housing which is student-friendly for visiting travelers. So try to look for staying in a college town like Boston or something else which might suit your needs. Of course, college towns on the West Coast are not going to be cheap, so just keep that in mind. A few other things to think about before you come to the US that might reduce your costs. One is, always have a budget tracker. Our favorite budget tracker is the Mint app. It really helps you plan a lot and manage your budgets in the US. The second one is thinking about differences between Queen's English and American English. The best way to learn American English, which might actually earn you a lot of bargains, is to listen to podcasts hosted by Americans. And do not listen to podcasts hosted by academicians. Listen to podcasts hosted by local Americans speaking about folklore, country music, and so on. We also must think about cultural sensitivity. An important thing to think about is driving license. If you can get an international driving permit before coming to the US, that might be a really good option. The last one is, last two are plastic money. Plastic money basically refers to credit cards or debit cards. A good credit card might actually build a credit score for you very early in the process, and you can apply for an international credit card as soon as you arrive in the US if you have any address. The last one is what we call Google Voice. If you have Google Voice, you do not have to pay huge amounts of money for getting a local phone connection like AT&T or Verizon. These phone connections for an individual might charge, you know, $60 per month or even higher, but Google Voice comes at a very, very low cost of almost 1 cent per minute of speech. So Google Voice is a very good option because US has a lot of cafes that have Wi-Fi, and you can actually access Wi-Fi and speak for free as much as you want, apart from using mobile data, of course. So this is it. That is a pretty comprehensive overview of what you can do if you do not have relatives in the US, different visa options through which you can travel to the US, cheap staying options in the US, and key considerations you must think about when you come to the US. Thank you.